And does that involve second element here, which we'll touch upon briefly, is after Alamina Ellen, Ba'amim Salihat, and do righteous deeds. And subhanAllah, the two are always correlated. It's very rarely you find Alamina Ellen was the only description given in the Quran, not accompanied with Ba'amim Salihat, performed righteous deeds, performed good deeds. They usually come hand in hand. They correspond to each other. They're two sides of a coin. They fall together. They balance each other. And the Prophet ﷺ is reported to have said, hadith that I shared with you last time, laysa imanu bi-tamanni. Iman and faith is not by wishful thinking. It's not by saying, I'm a believer, and that's it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive all my sins, and will grant me so much reward, and I'll be thrown into heaven, inshallah, I mean, to Jannah. That's not how it is. He says, laysa imanu bi-tamanni. Iman is not by wishful thinking, but it is what is affirmed in the heart and translated into action. And so a person that calls himself a believer and yet doesn't act as a believer is someone that is that has elements or has characteristics of hypocrisy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun.
Walk on this earth are those that believe and perform righteous deeds.
And And so we need to fall into both categories, form and and interestingly enough, scholars say that it's not enough to be exalted. It's not enough to be a person that is righteous inwardly. You have to be righteous outwardly. You have to be a Muslim as well. You have to have inner light, but not cocoon it, not hide it, not keep it inside, not walk this earth feeling that you're lit inside and you have this inner sweetness inside. It's not enough. You have to share it. You have to have that light spread out. Like a lamp that lights up a dark room. Likewise, every believer should be. You're sharing your light. You're sharing your belief. And hence the Prophet said, instruct the believer, and he will help me, but obey it. Report and recommend and translate and spread out and give out of me and of my seal, of my life. One verse, if even one verse, what a way. The Prophet is in his book of said, "Aqrabu ilayya yawm al-qiyamah," the most close amongst you to me on the Day of Judgment are the best amongst you in character. And hence, the worse you are in character, the more you difficult you are, the more of a temper you have, the more rude you are, the farther away you are from the Prophet places. And yet, the more lofty and high and moral your conduct is, your behavior is, the closer it is that you will be, inshallah, we will be to the Prophet. So it's most that you have to have that balance of being a Muslim. The Prophet says that you should not be lost the whole time. You should be dealing with people and interacting with people. And you should be struggling in this life. You should be a beacon of light, inshallah. And so the question that poses itself, perhaps addressing the second part of this book, is how? How can you be a beacon of light? How can your actions translate what you believe in? I'll leave you with that, inshallah. Many times when we look at the world today and how we live our lives here in the luxury and comfort of North America, we find something very interesting. We find immense creativity in how to enjoy your time. Immense creativity in how to enjoy your time. So many games, so many things to enjoy, so many things to play around with, so many toys, so many new iPads, or new iPhones, or new applets, or new Xbox games, or PlayStation games, and all these new technologies that are coming up that you can enjoy day in and day out. It's very rare now to find something without a smartphone. Facebooking, and enjoying Twitter, and enjoying this, and enjoying that. It's just so rapid, so much. How creative people have become in entertaining us. So many different types of entertainments out there. And I'm not talking about haram stuff. Okay? Put haram stuff all alongside. There's lots of haram stuff. And there's lots of creativity there. It's haram, I'm not saying don't do it. Right? But it's just so much. And people are so creative when they come to think of it. And we come to do it. And so, reflecting on this, it says, subhanAllah, if we only put a fraction of that creativity, a fraction of that creativity, in how to please the Most High, and how to do righteous deeds that please the Most High, just a fraction of that creativity to please the Most High. And so, interestingly enough, I came upon this forum post of a brother that was sharing some ideas that he actually tried. And so the brother starts by saying that, you know, no one on this forum actually knows me personally, and I'm posting it as an anonymous person. And this is not me bragging or not, you know, showing off in any way. I'm just sharing these ideas so that you may, inshallah, find it beneficial. And he lists a few things that he had done over the past little while. And so this is what he released. And so he says that one of the things he thought of doing was making many copies, cassette copies, of a lecture that he found very inspiring. A lecture that he found very inspiring about Islam and brings people closer to Islam and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he made 100 copies of this. And he says that every month he does this, he dedicates a portion of his salary to make these copies, to buy these tapes, and to make them and have them ready so that he may do something with them. What does he do? And the cassette tapes are released. So he has many of these cassette tapes, and he goes and stands in a very interesting spot and passes that cassette tape out to people that pass by. And that interesting spot is in front of music stores. In front of music stores. So anyone that comes into the music store, he passes out that cassette tape. He doesn't say anything, he says, you know, this is free, so say, plus, and they have it. And the people are kind of embarrassed, they don't say no, they just take it. It's free after all, perhaps they saw it, thought it was a sample from the music store or something. So they take it. And that's it. Every month he does this. He stands in front of the music store and does this different music store every month. And it says everything went fine, well, alhamdulillah, no problems. And I stand a little bit to the side so that I don't bother the store owners, so that no one actually, you know, complains against me. But one store owner was very rude, and he decided to blast some speakers out, you know, a little louder than usual, so that it may annoy me and cause me to leave. You know, maybe he just wanted to affect my eardrums and cause me to leave. And so he says, I decided not to leave, I decided to stay. Just, you know, no matter what that person does, I'm staying and I'm going to still distribute the tapes. And he continued to do so. And so it's just interesting how this person chose to do something that perhaps we all shy away from. We shy away from doing this. But yet it's so simple and so easy. Another idea that he thought of is very interesting as well. He says that in Fajr prayer, there's barely one line of prayer people. And they're mostly old people. Barely one line in Fajr prayer in the mosque. So we realized and felt, why is this the case? I mean, we're a Muslim neighborhood, there's lots of Muslims around. We should try to increase the lines of people that are worshiping and praying in congregation at Fajr time. And so we decided one day to speak up after the Fajr prayer, after the immense incident. I go and spoke up. And he said, I'm the youngest here, and I apologize if I take a few minutes from your time, but I just wanted to share with you some ideas that perhaps we could do. Let's talk to our neighbors, let's talk to our friends. Let's reach out to those that are around us and invite them to come to Fajr prayer. And let's remind them that Fajr prayer is so much rewarded, and that Fajr prayer on time is much more rewarded, and Fajr prayer in congregation is much even more rewarded. And who amongst us is not in need of good deeds? Who amongst us can say, that's enough good deeds for today? Who amongst us can say that? So let's remind them of this. Let's remind them of it and leave it at that. We won't force anyone. There's no compulsion in Islam. Alhamdulillah. Let go of the people. Just remind them. But that people think of that father. We need remind for a reminder is beneficial for the believers. Let's just remind them. But let's do this on a continuous basis. Remind once, remind twice, remind three times. And so he says that next week, Allah is the same. Week after the line was the same. But then after some time, over the course of 6-7 months, he noticed that the lineups increased. Now there were 2 lines. And after a few months, there were 3 lines. And so this brother started something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewarded him for. And we all know what he means with the Prophet, he says, the meaning of which is that man sanna sunnatan hasanatan fala ajra. Whoever starts a good deed, a good action, he gets the reward of it, and the reward of those that follow in his footsteps and do the same deed. It's powerful. So this brother got so much reward just by speaking on that. He didn't speak again. Another example that he brings forth is that at one point in time, he saw that the people that are cleaning in the streets, they were cold, and it was cold, it was winter time. So he decided to buy some plastic gloves that keep them warm and distribute them among them. Sin didn't do that, he decided to do that. So he went out and did that. And when he was giving them the gloves, they were surprised, and they thought they wanted something. He says, this is just for the sake of work, and I don't want anything in return. He says that a few weeks later, he noticed that many of the workers had gloves. And so he was elated and happy. He said, how many of them have got that? And last interesting idea that I'll share with you is that when Ain time came, he decided to buy some perfume and distribute it to whom? I was, subhanAllah, surprised by this. To the workers that work in the garbage field, to the garbage men, to those that deal with our filth, to those that deal with the worst smells, he decided to distribute some perfume on the day of Eid and gave it to him. Not frowning. It's the image of a believer that is frowning all the time, angry all the time, feeling anguish, resenting everything around him or her. That is an image that we want to rub away. Because to Rasul Ibn Wajih, the Prophet reported, you're smiling on the face of your fellow believer, of your fellow human being. And scholars say that here is not referred to just human, to just believers. All of humanity, you're smiling. Is it something? Is it charity? Act. So he did smile. Likewise, we should smile to our fellow brethren in humanity. One final comment, inshallah, about acting. What's something that perhaps many of us can actually do? MashaAllah, many of us have this blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many of us have other blessings. But this particular blessing is the ability to speak. The ability to speak. Or the ability to write. Write well. You read a paragraph for a brother or a sister, you're like, wow. It's very expressive. It's very powerful. Many of us have that gift, inshallah, that it is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, just a few days ago, the incident of the Nepal ban in the citizenship, or when they're taking the oath. SubhanAllah, I mean, when you hear Jason Kenney talking that way, you just feel mixed emotions. And so one comment, or a letter to the editor, was sent at the office, why Muslim? His name is Muhammad something. And so this brother sent this commentary, this letter to the editor, and sent it. So perhaps you would think, you know, he would curse Jason Kenney, he would say this, he would say that, he would do this, he would do that, he would be very angry, full of anger. No. No. He was subtle. He was polite. He was very much full of peace. He wasn't creating enemies. He was clarifying. He was explaining. He was addressing. He was, of course, against the decision. He was talking about it in a way that really adheres to the prophetic tradition, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advises the Prophet and tells all of those who follow in his footsteps, and if you were harsh and hard-hearted, everyone around you would have dispersed. Scholars say that being harsh and hard-hearted does not mean injustice. It does not mean that you are transgressive. Harsh means that you have the right to be harsh. You actually are harsh because someone has done something wrong to you. You have that right. Hard-hearted means you're not forgiving. And you have the right not to forgive, right? You've been wronged by someone. You have the right not to forgive. You have the right to be harsh to that person. Oh, we jump on that opportunity. It's someone wrongs us, we're very harsh. Very harsh, and we feel justified in being so. Because they've wronged us. We're on the right here. We have every right to treat that person badly. And they deserve it. That is being harsh and hard-hearted. And that is what Paul says to the messenger, if you were like this, you would have dispersed from amongst you, from around you. Believers would have not been around you. They would have been gathered with you. And likewise, we should follow in that prophetic tradition. If you want to deliver a message, if you want to teach, if you want to explain, and you do so politely, away from harshness, away from hard-heartedness, then this is the best way to go. With politeness, with peace, with tranquility, with ease, with a smile.